Hello, hello. How are you this evening? And hello. Here you are. This is Tessa-Marie, and welcome to the Tessa-Marie Show. How are you doing this evening? So this evening, it's a nice Thursday evening, and everything are looking really... Hi, Debbie. Welcome to the Tessa-Marie Show on this wonderful evening. I hope you enjoy it. So, in other words, I should greet you like this, Debbie. Here you are. Welcome to the Tessa-Marie Show. So, I am Tessa-Marie, and how are you doing tonight? So, here we go. Tonight, our IG Live is on challenges. And that is different, because the dictionary has certain meaning for challenges that we don't have, or we don't use, or we see it differently. So anyway, here we are. And it's going to be all about the challenges that we have. So when I saw that, I said, you know, let me see what the dictionary said about challenges. Because I'm looking at doing something on challenges, and I wanted to know, hi, Ali, what was being said about challenges in the dictionary? So it is a call or a summons to engage in a contest of skill and strength. Okay. So I went a little further. Something by its nature or character serves as a call to battle, contest, a special effort. That's what a challenge is. That's what it said. So I said, okay, going further, I'm going on. A call to fight as a battle or a duel, a demand to explain or to justify. All of that the word challenge covers. And then I came to this one. Difficulty in a job or an undertaking that is stimulating to one engaged in it. So that was really amazing. I like that one. And obviously, we have a choice. We always have a choice about how we see things. That is one of the things we do. We have a choice, hi Yoko, about how we see things. So what we define as a challenge is what we were taught to define as a challenge. So the choices we have to look at are many. And it's no wonder we navigate them differently. There are so many choices. And there are a lot of ways, as the dictionary was going ahead with. There were more, but I like this one, so I stopped there. I love the last one. I really loved it. The challenge we face is difficult, but it is also stimulating. And most people wouldn't see that. Because when the milk is spilled on the floor, that's what they see. The milk is on the floor. Nobody is moving to go and get something about the milk. So that's what they see. It's difficult. So my question is why? My question is why do we see challenges from the difficult and we do not see the stimulating part of it or the stimulating thing of it? If you have a challenge and it stimulates your very senses and your core, you should feel really good about it. And then I thought about the gladiators. They were facing other gladiators, but you could see they were challenged. They popped their chest out and they were out in it. And, you know, you didn't see fear on their face. They looked at the challenge in the face instead, and they're walking towards it. But we are not taught to do that. When we hear the word challenge, we all run for the hills like wild dogs are after us. Challenges come in and everybody's running away. We want to live a life free of challenges. But challenges are stimulating. That's what it said. The person who is taking in this challenge, it stimulates their senses. So as we are pre-programmed by the world, we were pre-programmed by our teachers. Did your teacher look at the first meaning in that list on the dictionary through and then said, challenges must be a battle, it must be a duel, people die, there's blood happening. And that's what the teachers told us, the worst part of it. The very first thing. It's a challenge, people are going to die. So it's no wonder, it's absolutely no wonder we all view a challenge from the most negative side. We see it from the negative side. What if we looked at it for one time and we saw it, the challenge, as something that can stimulate us to do better? You know, give us a better experience that wakes up our senses. Why don't we look at what is difficult as something that can stimulate us and wake up our senses and set us to do something, set us free to be our best we can? in every aspect of our life. What about if we took that? So that is what it did to me. Beginning, really, what would happen to us if we took it like that? Think about it. What would happen to us? But I know for sure that this requires reprogramming our subconscious mind to see a challenge as not the most difficult thing it is, but what we can do with it. And look at the challenge and all the occurrences in our life as stimulating. So I remember Norman and I were going up to the plantation and we were driving a Willys Jeep, open top. And the road to that place is like that. It's like a snake going straight uphill. And all of a sudden, the cable on the gear shifts broke. And we have a choice. The precipice on the left and the mountain on the right. And the road is for two vehicles, but it's like half of a one-lane highway. Half. It's so small. And we are stuck and we have no choice. Norman said to me, okay, he took the cable in his hand and steering. And he told me, you take the gear shift. When I say no, shift the gear. We are going like this, up the hill to the top of the mountain to go to Marisol. And we did that. And that was the first time in my life. I was about 18. And he was younger than me. And the energy between us, when we decided to do that, to take that chance and go home, it's night time. We have to go up to the plantation. There's no other way. There's no phone. There's no lights on that mountain road. The only light we have is the light of the truck, of the Jeep, that Willys Jeep with an open back. If we go into the precipice, we are dead. And if we hit the cliff, the bounce from the cliff would send us in the precipice anyway. No matter what we do, we are dead. So what choice do we have? He grabbed this cable in his hand, and I took the gear shift, and he has his steering wheel. So both his hands are working, and I'm there next to him. And I felt the energy in that challenge. Honestly, I felt it was like electricity passing from him to me. And we were just at the bottom of the hill, so we had a long way to go. And every time he would say, no, and I shift gear. Okay, second gear, third gear, no, put it up here. And that was, I always remember that. And finally, we got to the plateau, and now we're heading down to the plantation. As we are heading down to the plantation, I'm looking at his hand. It's bleeding from where he was holding on to the cable while I was shifting the gears. We made it down, and our dad saw us coming in, and he stood up on the top of the veranda and said, what happened? And he saw Norman's hand, and he took my mom came and helpers, and they wrapped it up. And we couldn't move. We stood there. We came out of the vehicle and we stood there. And nothing. He couldn't move, I couldn't move, because what we just experienced was so stimulating. Our body was so hot. My mom made us go in. She told us to sit. And I remember she said, here, you guys take this. She gave us a drink. We sat outside. We couldn't go into the house. We sat on the veranda, concrete railing about 18 inches thick and wide. We sat on that, looking up at the mountains, and we stayed there until 4 a.m. The sun was rising, and all we could do was just look at each other and smile. And it was 12 o'clock when we got home, midnight. And it was a challenge, but when we looked at it, we had no choice. We had no gears, and we're going up a mountain. The cable breaks. What do you do? He holds onto the cable. I am shifting. He's driving, and his hands is just bleeding. We come home. We sat there. We couldn't talk. We hardly could move, but we got home safely. Our choice was a precipice, going down the precipice, hitting the mountain, going down from the mountain, hitting into the precipice. One way or the other, we were gone. But that challenge, we had to take it. And we had to make it work for us. It stimulated us. And both of us felt the current of energy flowing back and forth between Norman and I like this. Because if we didn't have that connection, we could not have made it home that night. So we sat there, I watched the sunrise, and then we went to sleep. We sat on that porch, and I think all we did was drank whiskey that night, scotch. That's all we did. And then we went to sleep the next day. And when we got up, we spoke about it. And my dad looked at both of us. He had a habit of ruffling our hair. He ruffled our hair and he said, but you got it home. He said, you got yourself home. You did not let that challenge kill you, and you will never, ever forget it. He said, just relax and let it go. Eventually, you'll forget it. And we have never forgotten. Every now and again, when Norman and I are driving on that road, he looks at me, I look at him, and we just smile. So it depends how you take a challenge, what you do with it. Because it can stimulate you. It might not kill you, but it can force you to dig deep and come out on the other side. And that is what we had to do that night. So this, of course, requires reprogramming our mind, because we are taught in this world, when we face a challenge, to run for the hills instead of running towards it. You know what we have to do? We have to get away out of that. That is what we think. Get away out of that thinking. If we keep thinking that challenges are insurmountable, they will be insurmountable. We could have stopped on that mountain road and hope and pray no other vehicle is going up or down, but we decided not to stop. We had no choice. So a challenge is giving, looking at it and saying, I have no choice. I have to fix this thing. That does not jive, right? We're stimulating. You don't see that. I love feeling it. I love feeling a stimulation when I'm facing a challenge. I love feeling my senses open up. And I really do. So when I face challenges, and I have, that was simple in a sense because I was with my brother. And although I was the older one, he taught me to drive and he was younger than me. So you know what life was with six brothers. So anyway, so when faced with a challenge, can we decide to look, see, sense it, and feel the stimulating effect it's going to do for us to get it going? What are we going to do? So going up that mountain road with Norman, we had a choice. The cable on the Jeep broke. And it's him, he's younger than me. I am older, but I'm not driving. He's driving and he's the guy. He's my brother. He looks at me and he goes, when I say shift, you have to shift the gears. He's holding the cable in his hand and he's steering, and we're going up the mountain through the plantation. Choice. We couldn't stop and think. We couldn't stand still. We had to take the challenge on head on. We had to hold on. He said, shift the gear. I'm shifting the gear. I am going from first, second, whatever we need to climb up that mountain. In the meantime, my brother is losing his hand. It's bleeding. And all I can feel is electricity going from him to me, from him to me. And it stimulated us to do it. But when we got home, we were spent. We never slept that night. We sat on the porch, looked up at the mountain and drank scotch. And in the morning we went to sleep when the sun came up, and my dad told us when we woke up that we would never ever have failed. We had that. He said, you saw the challenge and you guys had no choice. You couldn't stay there, you would die. And we knew that. So when we face a challenge, because they tell us challenges are difficult, we should run for the hills. We haven't got to do that. So when we face them, we have to look at them and say, what can I do with this? We have to decide how to treat that challenge, to look at it and see it and feel it and know, what can I do with it? Because you might have a choice, as difficult as my brother Norman and I had. You might have that choice to look at the precipice on your left, look at the mountain on your right, and know no matter what you do, you're going to die. If you don't hold on to that cable and I don't shift the gear, we're going in the precipice. If we hit the cliff, the force will send us in the precipice anyway. So what is the choice? It's a winding, mountainous road. No lights, no phone. So this is what challenges are. You have to look at what is going on here. What can I do about it? And that is what you do with a challenge. You have to decide, how can I fix this? What can I do to make it work? Not what is going on with it now. It has already happened. So the pain of the battle or the duel or what you have is really worth it, because at the end you come home, or at the end you get over it. At the end you realize that this, if I can do that, I can do the next one. Bring it on. So challenges, you know, and I are there, and I wonder about you. What do you think when you face those difficult ones? Let me see. I know Debbie was here, Belinda, Nina, and who else was here? Ali. Oh, hello. Hi, Donato. You woke up. Anik, Yoko. Thanks for coming, guys. So what I want you guys to tell me, I wonder, what about you? What do you do when you face a challenge? What it is you do? You put your thoughts and just put a comment and tell me what you do when you have a challenge. Do you look at it and say, well, this is it, I'm dead, I cannot get over it? Do you cry? What do you do? Because the challenges that come to us is something that we have to know what to do. So you have to look at it and think, okay, it's not working, and I don't have a choice. Nobody else is coming. Like on that dark mountain road going up to the plantation, nobody else was coming that night. So could we have sat there? No, we couldn't. Our parents would be sick with worry. They knew we were out. So what do we do? And that is the question you have to ask yourself when you're facing a challenge. The dictionary said, the person facing the challenge, doing the stuff is stimulating. I know what that means. I experienced it. The other part of being telling you it's life or death, it's a battle, it's a duel, that is stimulating too. So what do? You can't walk away. So let me see what Nina said. My God, I needed this. I'm writing more legal documents through the night. Tonight, I'll try to remove emotions from the challenge. Thank God for you, Tessa. Thank you, Nina. I love that. But challenges, Nina, we have to walk through them. If we don't walk through them, they will walk through us. We have to face these challenges head on, because they will break you before you break them. And there is nobody coming. There is nobody coming to rescue you. When you have a challenge, do you notice nobody is coming? The people that you think that will come, suddenly they cannot come. Sometimes they really cannot come. Sometimes they don't know what to do. Sometimes they have no idea what to tell you. And sometimes when they show up, they become more of a challenge than the challenge. Because they sit there wringing their hands, and you don't need that. For that reason, it's funny, a different type of pain. When I had my first child, you had 5 days in the hospital, my first daughter. And I said, and it was a matter of observation of others who had kids before me, my cousin. And her husband's whole family was there when she came home from the hospital, everybody expecting something to eat and drink, and nobody's moving. I looked at the situation and I said, these people look like they came here to eat. So I just went and I ordered food. I put it in the kitchen. I said, I am out of here. So when I had my daughter 2 years later, I said to my husband, you tell everybody that they show up at the hospital and look through the glass, because I am not doing going through what Ina went through. And that's what I said to him. I said, you call them all. Tell them there's 5 days at the hospital. Show up there and look at that child through the glass, because nobody's coming here and expecting food from me. As a matter of fact, we're not having company for a month. And that is what I did. So it was a challenge having a new baby. You bring it home. None of us know what to do with it. You know this person has to be looked after. And all you need is in. That's a challenge. But when you have a challenge and another challenge come on top of you, what do you do? My cousin was lucky. I decided to order food, put it on there and say, you guys can eat. I took my purse, took my car, got out of there. And I told I was leaving. And I said, note to self, when your turn comes, this is what you have to do. So when you have a challenge, you have to be able to see where you are. But the most important thing, before the challenges come your way, prepare yourself to manage challenges. Prepare yourself to do that. Prepare yourself to know what to do with this challenge by observing others. See how somebody's behaving under pressure. Learn from what you see. Because what you see might not come to you that same way, but it might give you an idea. Okay, so when she was having this situation, that's how she behaved. Or that is how I shouldn't behave. And I call those very good bad examples. So when you see a situation where you shouldn't behave like that way, a challenge, something's happening, you say, you know what, I remember that. That was a very good, bad example of how I shouldn't behave. So challenges come, but our choice is how we take it. If it's stimulating, make it work for you. Find out. You cannot run away from it. There's no mountains in Toronto. I don't know where I would go. So I have to face it. I have to stay in it and fix it. And that's what we do. So challenges come, and they will always come. It might not be a big one. It might be a flat tire on the 401. Think. You think that is the time to go on the side of the traffic? Don't you think it's safer to drive on the rim and get off the 401, the highway? But if you don't think and you don't listen and you don't observe, you're not going to know what to do. And that is a challenge. And if you panic, you can be killed. So challenges is what you have to look at as they come. You look at them. That's why the older people said, don't cry over the spilled milk. It has already spilled. What is left to do? Get a mop, get a rag. I don't care what you get. Take a spoon. Pick it up, because it's not going to go away if you don't do something about it. And saying, oh my God, the milk is on the floor, is not going to make the milk miraculously come back into the thing it came from. So, you know, we could have stayed on the mountain road and said, well, you know what? We're going to just wish this cable get connected. No way. It was broken. So we had to deal with it. And that's what I always look at, what I learn. And when I come, I choose one word. Because the only thing I see is words. I don't see pictures. I don't understand pictures. I see a word. And when I see a word and I decide to write about the word, I bring it to you as I get it. And challenge was my word. I write a month ahead. So right now I'm writing for April. So challenge must have been done in February or January. So the challenge, I write about it. The word comes, or I hear the word. I see the word. Somebody says the word. Somebody says a phrase and I write about it. And or somebody, if somebody talks to me, like yesterday when the lady said that, I had to write about it. It was so strong. I needed to get it out there. So this is why when you get one of those things, I have thought about it. I worked on it. So Nina happens to come tonight and she said she needed that. So of all of you who came, one person said she needed it. That was important to me. And that's why I do what I do. I do it so that Nina, it was her turn to get her nugget. It was her turn to decide whether it was as value as a pearl or even more value than a pearl, a pink Canadian diamond. But somebody heard me tonight and it rang, it resonated with her. So this is why I do what I do. I do it so when you come, you get something out of it. Hi, Rosie. And that is important. Every time you come to one of these IGs with me, I am hoping you take something back. And when you don't know what to eat, give it to somebody. Give it free, because I give it to you free. I give it to you so that you can use it. Those things come to you when it's the right time. If you're dealing with a challenge and somebody says to you, this is difficult, and you come here and you listen and you get, no, it's something I have to go through. It's a passage in time. It's just what when I say happiness is a moment in time, a challenge is a passage in time. You have to go through it to come out on the other side a better person than when you faced it. And nobody can take that away from you. Nobody can tell you that's not true. And nobody will come and help you fix it. Your challenge is for you to manage. And you have to find a way to stimulate your senses, your nerves, your sinew, and ask them to serve you one more time so you can get through the challenge. And this is what I do. I bring it here for that reason. So I hope you had something tonight. And I hope you enjoy this. And I hope you enjoy the story of myself and my brothers. It's a true story. And if you see him and how tall and skinny he is, you'd wonder, really? That's what you guys did, but he was young and so was I, and we succeeded. So let me see what I've been listening to. Deepak Chopra too. His soothing words calm me. Thank you, Nina. So it's better to do wrong than to do nothing, because wrong is the way to the right path. Many times it is. It was, what we were doing was wrong. It was so wrong, it was not funny, because the boy could have lost his whole hand. But we had to get home and we couldn't stay on this mountain road forever. So thank you, everybody, for coming. Yes, that's sending your thanks, Nina, and some from me to you, too. Thank you, guys, for coming, and I really appreciate seeing you guys at night. And tomorrow morning at 8, and then I'll see you tomorrow. And Nina, you're in England, so it's past your bedtime. I just realized that. And tomorrow night at 7. And Sunday morning at 9:30, Yoko and I are doing legs and feet. So that should be funny. Self-care on legs and feet. So join us and have a wonderful evening. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Debbie and Rosie and Yoko and Nina and Ali and Donato and all of you guys who dropped in. Have a wonderful night. And Rosie, thank you for today. It was fun. I enjoyed that. Take care, guys. Bye.